Whilst the majority of FOSS is available for free, that doesn't mean there can't be means to purchase it. Great example being Critter available over on Steam. It effectively acts as a donation to the project and nicely puts it into your Steam library. For me personally, I would rather just donate to the project, but I understand why some might want to do this, and if you look at the reviews, clearly a lot of people have. But another great example is buying a computer with Linux pre-installed, where you're not really paying for the software, but the hardware comes directly bundled with the software, and it's all being treated like this singular product. And this creates a very interesting dynamic for these community desktop projects, where they can become the direct target, or maybe said another way, directly affected by various regulations, and WARE likes to make a lot of regulations regarding technology. That's right, the EU or European Union. So a couple of months ago, I put out this video about some prior regulation, or a different set of regulation. I guess technically the one we're talking about today started a bit earlier, but the effective date is sooner. Anyway, different set of regulation, where in this case, it was regarding power consumption, how devices idle, if you're going to have the option to disable power saving modes, providing specific kinds of warnings as users do that, making sure certain power saving modes are on by default, and things like that. This is something the desktop is in direct control of, so if they want to have devices being sold in the EU, they kinda need to care about it. And now we have another situation just like this, opened by Nate Graham, demonstrate compliance, EU Directive 2019/882. Now, as with every bit of EU regulation, it is very, very, very long, so feel free to read it all in your own time, because a lot of it is simply not relevant to what we are talking about today. The point of the regulation, though, the point of the directive, is on the accessibility requirements for products and services. So this is about making sure that screen readers work, and making sure that you have different color modes, making sure your theming works correctly to allow high contrast theming and things like that. And KDE already is in a relatively good state on this front, but there's still some things they need to clean up. Now, I was not able to find a similar issue over on the GNOME side, so if that happens to exist and you might know the name of it, where it can be found, better yet, actually have a direct link to it, please do let me know. Anyway, in a nutshell, it says your commercial product or OS that's incorporated into a commercial product needs to comply with a big list of accessibility guidelines to be sold in the EU. Now, you might make the argument, well, KDE is not actually an operating system, it's a desktop environment, so it doesn't need to comply with these guidelines. Yes, technically, KDE itself, Plasma itself, is not an operating system. But we don't really have a singular Linux operating system. The operating system is made up of these varying different components, and different parts of that stack control different things. And at the end of the day, it's going to become a singular thing sold in a singular product, so it's effectively in that same sort of boat. And Nate also says, this will be very important for vendors shipping KDE software. If they want to continue selling in the EU, they will have to demonstrate compliance. Because KDE is effectively a third-party vendor from their perspective, they'll want us to demonstrate compliance so they can say, we did our due diligence and our supplier attests that they're compliant. At the end of the day, KDE is a FOSS project, it's a community project. It doesn't need these vendors to exist. They could just say, we don't care, we're just not going to follow the guideline, and that'll be okay. But if they want to see devices actually shipping KDE software in the EU, which is obviously a very big place to sell devices, they kind of want to have to care. Now, being a directive from 2019, obviously, the timeline for this and the deadline for this has to be coming up soon. Well, June 28th, 2025, when he made the post less than 3 weeks away, as of the recording of this, about 11 days away. So, there's not much time to sort of iron out these problems. Luckily, most of the guidelines here are pretty sensible guidelines, and most of what's being done in KDE is already compliant or just not really relevant. Now, Nate has gone ahead and done a big breakdown of the directive to find what exactly KDE is required to deal with. So with this first part here, it means it applies to us in two ways. It applies to any operating system directly, KDE Neon, KDE Linux, which I doubt there's anybody actually selling devices with, and it applies to any vendors who sell hardware with our software because the software needs to be compliant. So obviously things like the Steam Deck, like KDE laptops, KDE desktop systems, and that's the majority of what you're gonna see. There's not really like KDE signboards, at least not that I'm aware of. Maybe, possibly, there's like a KDE-powered kiosk, but KDE is not exactly the kind of software you would use for that. To be fair, I think McDonald's uses, like, Windows 10, so anything is possible. This section here is primarily about the product itself, so the packaging of the device, how the device is constructed, stuff like that, not really relevant to KDE itself. If this is interpreted to mean any part of the operating system, though, conforming to WCAG contrast guidelines by default would probably be sufficient. This stands for Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, which is something a lot of places don't really conform with. For the first thing KDE actually needs to do, all KDE software must include documentation and it needs to conform to WCAG contrast guidelines and be readable using a screen reader. The documentation must describe the functionality and how to activate accessibility technologies. Now, most of the KDE software is documented. They would need to verify that it is readable using a screen reader. They would need to verify the contrast guidelines. But this is most of the way there. I don't know how well documented the accessibility stuff is, but like the core framework is there. It's just sort of verifying that it actually meets the guidelines. Also, all across the UI, it needs to have screen reader support. This again is basically already there. It's just something that needs to be audited, something needs to be verified, something that probably shouldn't break when things go wrong, or if it does go wrong, there is some fallback mechanism to ensure the user has some way to recover, some way to know something has gone wrong. This is an area which, again, the skeleton, the framework is there, but the effort needs to be put into to make sure it's as good as possible. When the product uses speech, it shall provide alternatives to speech and vocal input for communication, operation control, and orientation. This is already satisfied because there's nothing in the KDE suite besides, obviously, you know, things that require audio, like capturing your voice, where the only method to use it is through speech or voice input. This basically means if you have some way to do speech controlled text input or speech controlled application launching, there needs to be another method that is not speech controlled, which there's nothing in KDE where that's the exclusive way to do it. KDE already has Kwin Zoom, applications have magnifier tools, there are already brightness controls, and they already have a pre-existing screen reader as well. As for this bit, when the product uses color to convey information, indicate an action, require a response, or identify elements, it shall provide an alternative to color. This is a thing they do, but also needs to be audited. So you can't just convey information only through color. There needs to be text. Maybe there needs to be sound as well when something goes wrong. It doesn't have to be on all the time, you should be able to disable it, but there should be multiple means to indicate that an action is happening, especially if an action goes wrong. In that same vein, there is no case where only sound is used to indicate that an action happened, like a notification where you get a bell, but maybe there's no notification image, notification little pop-up thing. There's nothing where sound is the only thing that does that, so that's already satisfied. When the product uses visual elements, it shall provide for flexible ways of improving vision clarity. Now, contrary to what some people on the internet might think, KDE has no plans of getting rid of user configurable themes, and they already have color blindness correction filters as well. So basically everything there is already dealt with. They already have a built-in high contrast mode. If you don't like that though, you have user configurable themes and you can set it to anything you want. Now, one thing that KDE is missing is the need for audio speed and noise slash echo cancellation features. This just does not exist within the desktop right now. It seems like a weird choice to have at like a a desktop level itself. That seems more like the audio device you're using or the audio player. So I don't really get this one. And this one has had a bit of confusion around it as well. So what exactly that is supposed to mean isn't super clear. When the product requires manual operation and control, it shall provide for sequential control and alternatives to fine motor control, avoiding the need for simultaneous controls for manipulation, and shall use tactile discernible parts. Obviously has nothing to do with KDE because this is about something in the physical world. This would go back to the actual product you are purchasing. The product shall avoid modes of operation requiring extensive reach and great strength. Again, not really relevant to KDE. The only way this could be the case is if you have a 5 kilogram mouse and a 200 inch monitor, which again, not relevant to the operating system or the desktop itself. And a very sensible guideline, the product shall avoid triggering photosensitive seizures. I think we can agree that's probably a good thing, and it's something that does need to be audited, because things like the desktop zoom, like the color inversion, anything where you can change things back and forth very rapidly like that, causing a lot of visual stimulation, that possibly can be an issue, especially in cases where there are bugs. The product shall protect the user's privacy when he or she uses accessibility features. Already there, the product shall provide an alternative to biometrics identification and control. You don't even have to use it, it's not set up by default. By default, you're gonna log in with a password. It's up to whoever configured it to choose if they want to make use of that. Here's another one that might need to be audited. The product shall ensure the consistency of functionality and shall provide enough and flexible amounts of time for interaction. This needs to be audited for anything that might automatically disappear and maybe remove this functionality. Beyond that, this is so vague as to be unenforceable. So if you have something like a notification pop-up, it shouldn't disappear in half a second. How long that should be visible for is obviously up for debate, but I think the best way to handle this is just make it configurable. There needs to be a way to interface with assistive technologies. Obviously, this already exists with Accessibility KCM offering to open Orca and the global shortcut to turn it on and off. For this bit, the product shall comply with the following sector-specific requirements. Self-service terminals. Obviously, look, if there's somebody that has a self-service terminal running KDE, I would like to see it. And I don't mean like as a joke that you made yourself. I mean, you see it out in the wild. And this one's all about support services, which isn't really relevant to KDE. This is up to the actual manufacturer themselves. So what happens to KDE if they decide we're just not gonna do anything? Well, I kind of touched on this earlier. Nothing. Nothing at all. But there is something important for the vendors selling products in the EU. They have three options. One, pull any non-compliant KDE software and replace it with software that is certified to be compliant. So either write new software, find some other applications that already exist, whatever you need to do. Two, massively invest in KDE by sponsoring development to make everything compliant. Now, I'm sure the KDE project would absolutely love this outcome because then you get more development like you have from the Valve investment and various other things out there. And three, ignore the directive or plead ignorance of it and hope enforcement is spotty, delayed, or impossible such that they can wait it out until the directive is abolished, its requirements are watered down, or its commencement date is delayed further. Or everything is already addressed within the environment. That seems like an important point to add on there as well. To be honest, I feel like this may end up being how things end up going. Things aren't going to be perfect, and no one's really going to know if they're perfect, why they wouldn't be perfect. And then we just say, well, it's good enough. Let's just see what happens. Whilst that's likely how the products are going to handle it, that doesn't mean that KDE isn't doing work here to actually address this problem. So they have this action plan here for things they want to get done, and this also links out to a separate issue on all of the things laid out as sort of a checklist on what still needs to be done. There is one, there is one kind of annoying one that is kind of a bug. So, under a very broken context, Task Manager with hide other windows when hovering over previews can definitely flash at more than 3 hertz. So there's a situation where you can have it flash more than 3 times per second, which, to someone who doesn't suffer from seizures, is really annoying. To someone who does, you know, it's a lot more of a problem. But as you can see from the checklist, most of it here is just verification, ensuring that everything is up to scratch. Not that, hey, we need to rush to get everything done. It's, again, all of the framework, all of the skeleton is here, but we're not necessarily up to the exact guidelines they want us to be at. Which, considering the amount of time that is left until this directive actually goes into effect, is probably the best state to be in. Now, it's not like it goes into effect and then suddenly they crack down on everything. They would have quite a bit of time to get things dealt with, and it's going to be dealt with more and more over time. There may be just little areas here and there which don't get caught. Maybe they have an idea of everything needs to be done right now, but maybe there's some additional thing they didn't think of, some additional thing that comes to mind a few months from now. That'll be dealt with as they go, because as I said, these guidelines aren't really crazy, obtuse. Again, one of them's kind of obtuse, but like, guidelines that don't really make any sense to follow. It's stuff they were already trying to do anyway. This is just more of a formalization of the way you should be handling it. While some regulation from the EU can be considered kind of overbearing, I get it. At the same time though, when you're looking at cases like this, they were already basically doing everything anyway. So it kind of gave them the push they needed to actually finish that work, right? And this doesn't mean that accessibility is now going to be perfect. There's still absolutely issues. There's still bugs in the pipeline, whether that be in Pipewire, whether it would be in Orca itself, whether it be in Qt or anything else they might be using. But more push in this direction, I think, is just generally a good thing. And I would love to see more people talking about the importance of accessibility. If I keep doing this, right, like, I started talking about Wayland stuff, people started calling me a Wayland shill. How long until I'm an accessibility shill? You know what? That's not a bad thing. I'll take it. Anyway, if you like the video, go like the video. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, silly bear pay, linked in the description down below. That's gonna be it for me, and... What is this?